Is it okay if I sit? Can everybody see me? Okay, great. Last year's exam was extremely joyful. It was a really good 2 days. I think you guys will be about 3 days if I look at the count. Hopefully you will all stay until the end and submit everything. But yes, just a few notes or things from our side or from the excellent examiners, what we felt and what the industry needs from you guys, because after all you are going to be architects fairly soon, hopefully, candidate architects, and then after 2 years architects. But yes, you are now entering a new world, and this is sort of your thesis exam will be your most important day of your career so far, but believe me, there will be more important days coming in your career. So this is just a start of everything. So please don't stress, please don't get stomach ulcers, just do your work, don't procrastinate, that's all advice that I can give you. Finish. I always like to say, if I can do it, then so can you. And it's really true. I don't have special talents, I don't have special gifts. I can, I just work hard and that's it. Then back to the exams. What did we see? The good, the bad, and the ugly. We are going to start with the good first to put us all into a positive mood. And is it okay, Gerald, if I do it this way? I'm going to report back, and then I'm going to give them advice with that. So it's a little bit of letting you in on the secrets of what we want and what we don't want. So yes, and also believe us if we say what we want and what we don't want. We have a few years of experience, and I think I was the youngest or the second youngest or whatever. So there will be old toppies with grey hair and tunnies and everything, and they will know much more than what I know. So we know what we want. So yes. What we saw, the first thing what really impressed us was the beautiful hand drawings, the sort of the exploration of ideas through hand drawings, and almost the non-presentation hand drawings. That is always in architecture. I work for a very commercial firm, and we do a lot of computer work, but still hand drawings trump everything. We sometimes still present hand drawings, plans, and sections and some 3Ds as well. So that's sort of in the industry, clients love it, and we also love it because it's really your craft, that's your first instinct to go to. And I hope that's what you guys do, is you draw with hand. We are not saying present everything by hand, we are saying, include hand drawings in your book, in your presentations, etc. So not everything has to be hand-drawn things. You must discover what your tool is. If your tool is Revit, if your tool is AutoCAD, if your tool is Photoshop, whatever, how you put your visuals up, but the hand drawings work quite impressive. So yes. The students were also extremely well prepared verbally. There was this one guy, the one who did the blind center and so on, and you could see that he practiced for days before, and he was really so well prepared. And it really, it's what you have. You have your drawings to talk for you, and you have your voice to talk for you, to speak for you, whatever. So please prepare verbally. And I don't think you are going to use PowerPoint again. And it was an extremely good idea for the guys not to use PowerPoint, because you had to rely on your verbal skills, and that's what we mostly have in a meeting or whatever as architects. You just rely on your verbal skills. There's no crutch like PowerPoint, because I also believe that PowerPoint is a crutch. It could be an amazing thing, don't get us wrong, but yes, verbally it was well presented. And if you stand there and you're like, and here's my sections, and then we also feel like, that 80 is going to slip to a 70, So yeah, be excited and believe in your work, and the students who did that really did well. So yes. Then what we liked, and your topics have been chosen, I believe, and you are fairly advanced in your design development right now, we believe. The variety was really good for us. Sometimes other institutions they go and they do stuff in a group and they focus on urban or whatever. And what we like about this school is that you guys focused on urban, rural, landscape, all these things. So don't think that if your buddy chose an urban site, you must also do that. Follow your own instincts, and and so on. So we liked that as well. The exhibitions were very good. There was a fine balance between, you know, completely going over the top and, you know, giving the audience bribes or whatever, and then, you know, being completely toned down. So I think the students got that right, and the space was also really good for us. We enjoyed that. So nothing wrong with your exhibition space and the way that the students exhibited. And also I think the exhibition helped if it has a narrative, if it has a story to tell. You know, you take us through going step by step. Sometimes last year we got a little bit confused about the order of things and so on. So just make sure your exhibition makes sense, okay, and the way you are going to talk through that. And also, you don't have to jump through hoops. You don't have to, you know, like go and print on gold-plated paper. I don't know. You know, you don't have to do that because we can see right through the bullshit. It's really, I can't say that enough. We have like 13 years minimum experience, and you know, an architect sees what an architect sees. You know, you can't really baffle us with flashy graphics or you know, fancy 3D printed models that took 300 hours or whatever. We see right through it, and we know what shortcomings there will be. So just remember that. Also, there was a commendation on the research and your credibility of the arguments. You guys, or the previous year, went through it step by step. They sort of had a story to tell. Once again, there was a narrative in the books as well. And it was quite clear, concise, and sort of comprehensive as well. The guys that didn't do so well were the guys who had 300 page books, who really, you know, they didn't manage to filter through the essence of the information. So you must really, in your books, filter and you know, get the essence of what you want. And merely just copying the resources and so on, it's not working for us. We can also see that, you know. So it's fairly easy just to see. And Professor Stein also talked to you about plagiarism and all of that, so I don't need to repeat that, I think. You know, it's really, you can easily see that if your source was really just copied and you didn't make it your own and you didn't, you know, filter it down to the essence of what you want to say in the book. So yes. The students mostly addressed real issues. They mostly had real sites with real needs and so on. So that was also a good thing. I'm not going to say too much about it. And I believe that each of you have a real scheme and a real issue that you're addressing. So yes, whether it's a retail center or a hospital or whatever, you know, I suppose you guys all have that. Then. Also, it's just coming back to the books, sorry, I'm just reading from my notes. The books were mostly tasteful, they were well planned, they were comprehensive, and there was a story to most of the schemes. The people who did really well. I just want to highlight Victor Mugawa's book, it was amazing. So if you can get hold of that, just the process and the narrative he went through, he did a really good job of that. The design resolutions and the design development, most were really good. You know, we could see where a student comes from. And many of the design developments of the students were included in their book. So there was this one guy, I can't remember, but in the book he had the site layout this way, and then you could see how he changed it that way, and there was a reason behind it. So we could see, you know, step by step, you know, the choices that student made, how it has been done. Is everybody still with me? I see a few frowns and blank faces. We are informal here, so just stick up your hand if you have a question towards that. Then I'm going just to move over to the shortcomings, but we will take the discussion forward as it goes. And if I remember something that was good, I will also take it, you know, through with you. The first thing that was really concerning was for you guys to be careful of throwing around trending architectural terms. I'm just going to read a few that we discovered. Biophilic phenomenology, adaptive reuse. That's my favorite pet name. Adaptive reuse. What the hell? What, it's just additions and alterations. Yeah. Collaborative space. Collab. You know. Liminal, oh my word, liminal. what the hell is that? What is liminal? Bespoke and explores the notion, and also activates the space. You know, what activates what? You know, and then also phenomenology and regionalism. So if you do use those words, I'm not saying don't use it. If you do use that word, your architecture, your argument, everything must reflect the essence of that word. Don't throw around words in your presentation, abstract, and your book that just sounds nice architecturally. Okay. On OcDaily, there's an article, you can just Google it, 150 words that architects overuse or something like that. So go and look for those words and be careful of them. I'm not, like I said, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying don't use it, but use it carefully and with intent. Okay. So if your building is biophilic, it must really be biophilic. There's no, you know, just throwing the term loosely around. Okay. So those are really, or because people get on a trend, universities, they jump on this bandwagon because your friend is studying at Tux and the other one is studying at UFS and so on, and it's like cross-contamination, and we see that every year, that the students have these trending words, but anyways, be careful of that. Like Karl Lagerfeld said, trendy is the last phase before tacky, so there you are. Then drawings and drawing conventions. Okay, guys, you're 5th, 6th years now, some 8, 7, 9, whatever. You guys should know how to draw by now. We expect to see a difference between a wall and a door and a wall and an opening and a wall and a roof line over it and things like that. We are architects, we stand closer to your drawings. And the only thing that can speak for you then, if we scrutinize your drawings and your books and so on, it's not you who will defend yourself and say, okay, no, but I actually mean that. It's your drawings. It's only your drawings. So make sure your drawings are correct. Your drawing conventions are there. It's basics. It's stuff that you learned in first year. And drawings, architectural drawings, take preference over graphics. Okay. We will talk about graphics extensively just now, but the first impressions of your drawings, you know, if I always, and that's a first year thing, you stand back 5 meters, you squint, what do you see? Do you see a big blob of orange of your graphic, or do you see, you know, the cut lines of your section? So check that, and ask your friends for input if you are unsure of it. So and also with your drawings, you must always think, in your scheme, condition yourself. What do I want to say? Am I adding enough or am I adding too much? What do I want to say? It's always that big question. What do I want to say with my drawings? What do I want to say with my thesis, my most important day in my career so far? Okay, so you should know how to draw, like I said. Thresholds is very important. We in many cases we saw like on a plan and then the grass just begins at the door. I think on a 6 year level that's not on. So threshold, what is after a door? What is, you know, stuff like that. So that's very important. Then the most important thing actually what I needed to put first is your books and your abstracts, your written word, your language. Guys, this is all about time management, and every year we see that. I know what happens. You sort of rush it, and then you send it off to the to your editor or the language checker, whatever they are called. Sorry, and then you still do stuff, and your figures are not right, but you just put it in, and then the examiner needs to get your book, and Professor Stein is angry at you because you know you're late. What was that? And the printer. Oh my goodness, the printer takes forever, and you know. We've been there, you know, so we know what happened. So finish before the time and have your language checked. Make sure your figure references are right, because it's really influencing your marks. You don't know that, but a really good book can become really bad if the first word is misspelled. And that's what happened in one of the very good students' thesis last year. So make sure your abstracts are spell checked. If the editor is done with your work and you know, ask one of your professors. You know, really, it's really, really important to have your book checked. And titles are actually also non-negotiable. You must actually hope you don't get me as an examiner, because I don't know what happens, but my eyes zoom to the spelling mistake or the figure mistake or whatever. I'm like a spelling Nazi, and most of us do that. You know, if you've been working that long, your eye sort of focuses to the, you know. Do the thing. So I hope this really sunk in, because we see this every year, and every year it's the same thing, and tears, and you know, all sorts of things. So yeah, very, very important. And then also what we picked up was the context design, or your, I deliberately didn't want to say urban design, because not all of you are working in an urban context, but these are a few chapters from Lynch, or you know, Alexander, or whoever the urban designers are, and you know, simply just a few diagrams, it's not going to cut it for us. Design your context, whether it's a, you know, we want to see where you are coming from, we want to orientate ourselves to your site, because we are new and completely, you know, oblivious of what you want to tell us. And the sooner you sort of design your context and take us through to what your, you know, immediate surroundings are, the better in your books and in your presentation and so on, so that we can orientate ourselves and we can say, oh, it's there. Because last year we also had a few issues to orientate ourselves, and we were like, the panel was like, oh, where is it? No, it's there. And we were walking around. You don't want that. You don't want your examiners to be confused as to where your site is. And also, you know, if you talk about urban interventions, I know it's lightly addressed in your syllabus, but if we talk about that, then we should know, you know, what does your street furniture look like, and what does your paving look like, and where are your bollards, and how do people actually get to your site? You know, those things are very obvious, but I completely understand. I've been there, and I've made my mistakes as well. You focus so much on what is here in front of you and to get this done and to get this nice building up that you don't look at the bigger picture. So yeah, it's very important. And sustainability, I made a question there, and I know it's a very difficult thing, and you can differ from me, Gerald, and see if you want to, but things like saying, okay, I'm going to put a hot water system in, and you know, a geothermal. Geothermal was very big last year. I don't know why, but you know, if it's not something that you are completely sure of that will work, you know, don't put it in. And your building should be sustainable in its essence from the beginning. So no gimmicks of, you know, if there's a PV panel on the roof, it should be designed in. If there's, you know, we live in a day and age where sustainability, it's not an option, it's not an extra, it's not the last chapter in your book, it's the essence of your building. Okay, so work with that, and yeah, it's not an add-on, it's not an extra little thing. We picked that up with the students for the past few years. They think about it afterwards, and really, yeah, it's not, it's actually a non-negotiable thing. Then, yeah, time management is of essence. Like I said just now, I can't manage your time for you. Professor Stein can't manage your time for you, although he is making a really good effort to do that. But, you know, it's, you have to manage yourself. You must actually write yourself some goals, and you must say, okay, I'm going to be finished with this by then. I'm going to be finished with this by then. I need to submit my book, but I'm going to, allow a week for printing and a few days extra for contingencies. And, you know, I'm going to keep my my drawings covered in plastic in case there's a freak rainstorm, or, you know, stuff like that. It's managing yourself, managing your time. There were so many students with so much promise, and it just didn't happen for them. So, and it makes me angry, and it makes me sad, because, you know, if you have that talent, you must develop it and evolve it and work towards your goals. So yeah, like I said, I think I was one of the less talented students, but I worked hard, and that actually made me what I am today, because, you know, talent can be taught, talent can be discovered, and can be evolved. But, you know, I get so angry at those guys with the talent and who make these beautiful sketches and so on, and they just don't finish in time, because they know they can get away with it. But this year you are not going to get away with it, okay? Because we can see through that. We can really see through that. So yeah, that's all I wanted to say. So you get the message, time management. Then structure. Now it's a difficult thing, because you don't necessarily have a lot of structural academic background, but guys, if you do a basement, then there's a certain basement grid that works. We last year we had columns in the driveways, and you know, we had, like, you know, certain things. If you are unsure of how column spacings and so on work, go to your structural lecture, go to one of the other, go to one of the architects, because we, your mentors have like an intuition. Architects get an intuition for structure because our buildings have to stand up. And we will tell you very quickly, Marinda and Peter and all of them, you know, they will tell you very quickly, no, you know, there needs to be a column here and here and here, and that 10 meter span of yours and that 50 meter cantilever or that 100 meter cantilever that you want, that's not necessarily possible but with this, but let's see how we can tie your structure back and so on. We are not looking for perfect structural solutions. We are just looking for your understanding of architectural structures. Okay, so we don't want a technical drawing, and we don't want you guys in the exam to say, I consulted my structural engineer. Whatever, you know, so we don't want that. We just want you guys to have that sort of resolution and intuition for that. And stuff that makes sense. A column in the driveway is not on. Okay, so yeah. Then we get to the graphics. Okay, we all love graphics. We all love to show off our graphic skills. Oh, I've been there as well. And it's a good thing for architects. And we actually want to be mini graphic designers, all of us. We love fonts. And, you know, it's amazing. It's great. But let the architecture speak first. That is so important. You can have the nicest presentation, and like I said at the beginning, we can see right through the bullshit. It's so true about everything, and the examiners don't even talk to each other, and we try not to influence each other with marks and so on, but our marks and our observations are every time spot on, and you know, there are a few differences and so on, but it's always, we have the same comments and the same things and the same questions, so please make sure that your graphics don't overwhelm your architecture. And by all means, enjoy it. It's very nice, and it's one of your last chances actually to go wild with it. So go wild, but go wild in an architectural way. Okay. There are so many things so many nice inspiration things on Pinterest and the Arc Daily website. I'm referring to it constantly, but also on what is it, Behance and so on. You know, to do tasteful architectural graphics, and What is really nice is a very big section, you know, long section also, whatever you're doing with your building, or a very high section if you're doing a high rise, you know, to show us what your thinking was in your design development and so on. So just look at those things and look at architectural graphics, not, you know, not cheap and nasty splatters and 50 million colors. We don't want that. It's good. Then also another contentious issue is a computer rendered 3Ds, and some of you will be very good with that, some of you will be less good with that. But actually what we want to see is if you decide to do computer renderings, we want to see the materiality of your buildings, and we want to see it in an architectural way, not in, hey, I can do Max, let me show you my fancy skills. That's not what we want. Or I can do V-Ray and Photoshop and so on. We don't want to see gymnastics of rendering and Photoshop and so on. And we don't want to hear, oh, I switched on my render engine for 24 hours and it crashed at the last minute. We also know it happens, you know, but what do you have to show for us? My client tells me, you know, oh, I'm sorry to hear about your sad story, but where's my building, you know? So it's a bit ruthless. And yes, that's what the industry is. And we, you know, rather do a hand sketch that shows the materiality. Where are you using bricks? By the way, there's a nice prize for the best student in Goro bricks. So just saying, you know, don't all use bricks now. Okay, but yes, if you use bricks, where you used concrete, where you used, you know, steel, that sort of language, that sort of design development must show. Okay, doing black and white renders, it's very nice, but then, you know, texture it in by hand or with Photoshop, or, you know, I'm not saying you should do color renderings with wild things all over. We're just saying show your materiality and your design intent in your building with stuff like that. Use it as a tool and not as a communication, or use it as a communication tool and not as a smart, I want to impress a panel. Method. Okay. Yeah, and just on that, the materiality wasn't always communicated with the previous year. So we really expect this year to show your poetics of your design intention. That's very good. Or that's very important to show, you know. Because, you know, after all, that is what architecture is. It's, you know, what do I see where do I come in? Where do you know what is my building? How does it nurture if it wants to nurture? How does it protect if it wants to protect? How does it house if it wants to house? You know? So yes, I think that's all from this side of the tips from last year and all the inside information from last year and our thoughts. I don't know if you have any questions that I hope I can answer. Nothing. How are we doing for time, Gerald?
No, 25 minutes. That's very good. There's still some time for a break yet.
Okay.
So, is there anything else you want to discuss specifically there with your notes, or can we go to the brochure thing?
I think let's go to the brochures and then we can maybe talk in a little bit more detail with that. Did I cover everything that you guys are wondering about? Yes.
Should the design, like the final design, should always be kept for the last part of the presentation? Should you never ever say, like, let's say you wanna put it as your first presentation and you just wanna wow the judges? Always save it for the last.
I think it's important, remember, because all of the entire panel is, they are all architects or architectural educators or whatever, they have architectural experience, a very good architectural experience. And I think it's always good to tell a story, to have a narrative.
Yeah.
So I think to take people through the process, and I think what one of the students did, actually, I can't remember who it was, he showed, he or she, they showed glimpses of their design, but it was a little bit erratic. We are used to a certain way of, you know, I want to show you how I thought and how I, you know, developed it and took the site and so on. So the short answer for you is to, you know, save it for last and have a story that leads up to those drawings, okay? But there's, you know, I'm not saying keep it all for the last. I'm saying, you know, you can maybe put some hints of your final design inside. That was quite nice. The one student specifically did that. You know, he put some hints towards the final design. It can make people confused. So you don't want to confuse a panel or your book reader or, you know, your main examiner, because, you know, be very careful of that. Okay. Yeah.
You didn't say a lot about the final models. You said about
okay.
3D print or the print or the...
Your 3D printer, yeah. Well, I'm not saying also 3D printing is wrong, by all means go wild. It's a great technology. But we, last year, what could be nice, obviously it's your final design, it's your final scheme. We expect some sort of a final model. The final model doesn't have to have trees and fluff and laser cut perspex and... It could be a really nice architectural model out of that grey chipboard. That's what we call it, and triplex. It could be just that. Be careful of the laser cutter. I know the laser cutter is an amazing machine, but also just a tip: if you do laser cut, the edges become burnt, and just, you know, wipe off those edges and spray it white. It just makes a nicer model at the end. So a very simple architectural model. You don't have to go through, you know, a lot of detail, but people can immediately see your building, your design intent if you look at a nice model. I think it was a model last year out of Balsawood. I can't remember.
No.
Or a few years before, which was really amazing. But we are all cash trapped or not. And that Balsawood is amazing and awesome and so on. But, you know, a simple triplex model showing your intent. And what can be very good and what adds to the whole process is your design development models, obviously, because, you know, you need those little models that just shows it could be out of anything. Breakfast boxes, when I was a student, that was the trend to use breakfast boxes or Kellogg's or whatever. But whatever you use to do your concept models, just to show the spaces. And even if it's a bit broken, you know, just put them neatly out and show us, you know, what the whole process was till you got to that, your final model. So yeah, models are important, but please don't, please don't go too wild. And if you want to, then fine, do it. You know, spend 300 hours on the 3D printer. It's okay, it's really fine. It's just, ask yourself the question, is it going to add to my, you know, my design intent, or is it going to cause me misery? Ask yourself that, and yeah, make the call. You're all mature enough to do that. Anything else? Any other questions?
Let's see what comes up.
Cool, yeah, okay. Let's see what comes.
Right, let's... Riëtte has a point. Now, you, about 24 last year, they were 14. And it took 2 days, and I'm absolutely adamant that one shouldn't stretch their days. Everybody gets tired, including the examiners. And it's not fair to anybody to make the day too long. And I've been to too many occasions where the external examiners were zonked. They were so tired. And then, I mean, it is simply not fair. So I like to stop at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So how are we going to do it with 24 students? I don't know. But if you look at the program from last year, we only started at 9 and we stopped at 3. And it worked very, very well. Everybody was fresh. They could go out, go to the gym or whatever. That was last year. Then look at the exhibition spaces, and we'll do it again this year. We'll have the same sort of layout, and you decide who gets what. It's a collective effort. You'll have to fit in 23 or 24 spaces in our building that will be there for three or four days. So it's not, Grief can't have a space today, and tomorrow Louis takes that space. It stays up. So you'll have to sort that out, and if we show you the exhibitions, you need a lot of space. But I must tell you, I read about a Dutch artist. He's very, very famous. It's not Jeff Quartz. But when he does an exhibition, he gets invited to do an exhibition, he goes to the venue first and looks at the light and the whole ambiance of the neighborhood, who's going to visit. Then he goes, now he's got all the panels, and then he goes out to his studio and start working for the exhibition. He themes it, and you know, and I think Elaine's got very much that sort of idea. She's planning her posters and stuff. That's the impression I got. And that's a good thing to do it now. So next year, if you withdraw straws, if you get a small exhibition space, you do a small building. Okay, just keep that in mind. Okay, let's go through this. I think this can be valuable. Brendan. Riëtte is not going to talk about him. She's going to discuss those for which she has written reports. But Brendan got 80%, and he really had a very good scheme. Very good. Then we have Paul van der Westhuizen. Paul van der Westhuizen, he was one of Riëtte's students, and he got 62 with his makers, collaborative center for makers.
Yeah, I'm just going to take you through the notes, and the average was 62, so a few people gave him a bit higher and a few people a bit lower, and yeah. So just quickly, his strengths, he had a relevant topic and he was addressing a real need. So yeah, that makers, there's a big, big movement in the States, and it's coming over to South Africa, 3D printing, laser cutting, makers, you know, and robotics, electronics and so on. That was a real, real good topic. And maybe we expected so much of it, and I was getting really excited when reading his document. He had a concise document, and he was actually going to check his document because he did such nice practical research. He actually went to some of the makers, up-and-coming makers in Pretoria and so on, and he measured out physically the sizes. So he had real interviews with real people, and that was really, really good. His concept development was well explained. I think he was a guy who showed us his rationale of why he put his building in certain positions on the site. And then a good understanding of people's needs, and it just goes with my previous point of, you know, his research. His research was practical, well-rounded, and you know, physically, that impressed me specifically very, very much. Okay, so shortcomings. No page numbers in table of contents. And he was missing some sort of a narrative, some sort of a story. It seems like the candidate is merely quoting facts and applying theories to his argument. And you must make your work your own, you know. You mustn't feel like somebody bullied you into a topic or, you must really be passionate about it and tell the story. A few years ago, I think Nadia Lloyd-Lister, she told this amazing story about this panda or this bear or whatever from the zoo. And you don't have to tell like a story, but that intrigued me a little bit, and I was eager to read a little bit more. So have a narrative about your work, about, you know, I'm not saying put a person in there and tell a story about them. You understand what I'm saying? I'm saying that your work must have like a sequence to it, and that's it. Yeah. Then make the logos as part of the document is not necessary, and please remove. He took logos from the internet or whatever, the maker logos, and like I said, it's a big movement in the States and so on. And he put it everywhere in his document. Why? I don't know. So don't do it. Then the case study in certain chapters, it was very erratic. Please revisit the order to make it easier to read. So his case studies were a little bit all over the show. So once again, have a sequence. Think of it. This is an age-old thing, and it's a bit blasé, but your mom has to read the book, and she has to understand the book. Okay? So think about that. You know, you have to tell a person your story. Okay? And your book must read easy. And then only two precedents, a more in-depth study is required. Oh yeah, that's also something that I can add. Your precedent studies need to be really precedent of typology, precedent of materials, precedent of this, and many of the students had that. But you can't only have two precedents. It shows us you didn't really, and in the same breath, you can't have 50 precedents. It must be boiled down to what you want to say. And you must tell us why you chose those precedents and analyze it. Many of the students had very good, the best analysis of a precedent that I actually got was some of the students who made diagrams, who physically drew their own diagrams of the precedents and little details of the materials and what, to show us how they analyzed it. So this guy didn't have a lot of precedent, academic background there. And then the urban interventions should be looked at in more detail, and one cannot merely list it or put it in a diagram or whatever. It should be designed. Your building as a context, it should be designed. Right, aspects that need clarification. Also, just putting sexy diagrams into your book or on your document, you know, it needs clarification. There was a diagram that I didn't understand. The meaning of the diagram and how it will relate to the architecture is unclear. Architecture is the first thing that you must think of. The fluff can come later. Okay, so yes. The meaning, the site is an edge or a gateway site. What makes it unique, and is it appropriate for the proposed building? Okay, the one of the many important things that I'm saying today is don't miss opportunities. Okay, don't miss them. And because he chose a gateway site, and he could have made so much of that site, and you know, what do people see when they are driving this way, and what do people see when they're driving that way, or walking, or flying, or whatever. Okay, so you get that. Don't miss your opportunities of your site, of your building, of your design, of your story. Okay, The building massing is not explained in terms of urban context. Yes, you must mass your urban context. It's, you know, we want to see how it sits in the urban context. We want to see how it goes up and down, or, you know, how it stands out or how it blends in. We want to understand it, because although we know the site, we don't know the site like you know the site. Yeah, you must understand that. You're also the building. Is the building a landmark? And if so, how is the design achieving it? If you want it to be a landmark, fine. If you don't want it to be a landmark, fine. But how are you going to achieve either one? Okay. Then, also a thing on the practical side, fire escape strategies. Because you are designing a building that should be occupied by people. And don't let that, you know, sidetrack you. But think about it. Think about, I have one, or if you have a multi-story building, I have one common lobby, one stair, maybe I need some other stairs as a means of an escape. I'm not saying go to a fire consultant, because they are not easy to get hold of, but, you know, just ask your lecturers. If you're in doubt, ask someone in the industry, just a little bit. You don't have to learn the Sun's 10-400 part T by heart. You just have to understand what you need. 1.5 meter wide stairs. Landing's not higher than 5 meters for the disabled, or 1.5 meters for the disabled people. Just basic things. Just touch lightly to show us you don't only have a theoretical and an academic background, but you also have a practical background as well. And can you see that architecture is not easy? It's bloody difficult, man. It's just a deal. I still struggle with it every day. I said the materiality of the building is not shown, colors, textures, and also degrees of privacy and security. How do you walk through your building? How, you know, where is it secure, where is it not secure? We live in a real world. We have security issues. And like I said, also, don't become obsessed with it. Just be realistic about it. Then credibility of the argument, it was credible, there's a need of collaborative spaces and maker spaces such as this. Theoretical investigation, I said that is very good without unnecessary jargon. And I also said in the same breath, it needs more substance and in-depth theoretical research. Some of the documents, not all of them, but some of the documents were lacking in that the theory needs a little bit more substance. And it doesn't mean more pages in your book. It means showing that you have an understanding of the theory behind your concept, behind your section, behind your site, behind your everything. Okay. So you said, and it shows. It just shows in the scheme. Right. Then is design resolution. There's a clear concept development. The structural grid was questionable. Columns in roadways, inefficient grids, etc. So yeah, the facade response to the street and more private spaces. How will that be resolved? So that needs to be resolved in your design development. And also services as an expression of the aesthetic. So the student had a service-heavy building. If you don't have that, then don't do it. But his services could have maybe been, you know, expressed a little bit better, you know, pipes running on the facade or different colors or whatever. So he just thought that was a missed opportunity. Then his technical investigation, working drawings. And please, guys, just a tip, personal tip, don't see that as a separate thing. It's, although it is a separate subject, it is part of your design. I almost want to say, if you submit a design without technical resolution, it's not a design. So your technical investigation, don't think you're gonna, if you run out of time, I'm gonna submit the subject later on, next year, whatever. That actually shouldn't be allowed. Because that is your design development. How that looks is extremely important. And if I read through a book, I sometimes go back to the technical investigation. It tells me a lot more about the building than your fancy design sketches. Okay, so extremely important, your technical investigation. And for some guys, unfortunately, it really looked that they ran out of time, and we know that they ran out of time. So yeah, it seems incomplete. And then, you know, something unnecessary, like no need for waterproofing or tanking details at this level of study. You do that in your third year. This technical investigation should show your ability to understand the building's tectonics and reinforce the intended architectural language. A waterproofing design I can get from a rep. A waterproofing design I can get from my structural engineer or whatever. You guys learn that in your third year, hopefully. But I don't want to see that. I am interested in your design intent. I'm interested in to see how you resolve edge details, how you resolve your, the finish of your building, and how certain mullions go over things and how they clip onto each other. You know, I want to see that. Don't want to see a waterproofing detail or a foundation detail. You know, and it's not only me, it's all of the examiners. You know, like I said, we really see through the fluff. Okay, then referencing and references, that was another topic that we had to comment about. Many figures are not described. Please make sure all images are described according to the method prescribed by DUT. I still use the Harvard method. Figures should be described and numbered accordingly. No negotiations. No, none. Okay. Then general comments. The size of the project was appropriate. It wasn't too ambitious. It wasn't too small. It was a comfortable size. And then the detail and technical design resolution is questionable. That was just general. And then the recommendations that we made, and we recommended that the student do that, you know, as an addition to the book, or, you know, just refine his book. And then a more in-depth precedent study is required. We insisted on that. There are definitely more than two precedents on the topology, form, and materiality of this design. So, yes. There are quite a few pixelated images. If no high-res images could be found, the candidate should sketch and scan it. Okay? No pixelated images in your book. Why? It just looks so crap. It just doesn't do anything good for your book. If you can't find it, sketch it. That's, you know, yeah. Then many figures are not described. Please make sure all images are described according to the method prescribed by TUT. We insisted on that. Okay. So that was his comments. And I think he did fairly okay. It was a nice scheme and everything. So see this as not taking the poor guy apart in his absence. See this as tips for you, how you can improve in your thesis.
Also, what I'd like to add is that Paul was very well prepared when he spoke. It came over a bit too mechanical, but because he rehearsed it and he memorized it, but at least we respect the preparation that he made. Anything, it was very, very fluid.
Yeah. You know, especially his verbal presentation, it was so nice because we knew he was, we knew he was prepared.
And that counts.
Yeah.
Do you want to say anything about Susan?
Your son.
Susan got 44.
Some of the things that she did, she was extremely nervous, and we can't tell you to put your emotions apart. You know, it's a tough year, and if you start to, you know, become very emotional on that day, then it's fine. But just, you know, try to gather yourself after that. We all understand that it's a big moment. But gather yourself, you know, take a few breaths. The panel is extremely sympathetic. And we are not monsters. We won't eat you alive. We won't diss you and get into your character. That's not what we are about. So just that one thing. And also, we could see, and it's not saying anything bad about Susan at all, but because she's a really great person, she didn't listen to her mentors. Your mentors know, okay? You don't know what you don't know. that is my biggest argument with people who just start working or so, because you think you know freaking everything. You think you have this little God complex, and you know, but she was very, she made bad choices, and she didn't understand the structural implications of her scheme, and she got hammered, you know, by some of the examiners on that as well. So make sure you listen to your mentors, and you visit them every week, and you have a sound architectural solution. Also, it was especially with her where there were quite a few drawing convention issues. So it wasn't only her, but it was especially, you know, on some of her images. For me, there was so much potential as well in her scheme. It was, for me, extremely sad not to see her pass or do well, because it's such a touching and heart-wrenching almost issue, and it was a pity. I hope to see her today, but will she come back?
No, she's taking the year off.
Okay.
Because she asked me what must she do now.
You must
submit. And I said, I can give you a list of things you did wrong and how to fix them. She said, what are they? I said, listen.
You could see she was also, what is very important in the exam is also to remember to not try to pick an argument with your examiners. They do know better. You know, it's just how it is. And if they ask you a question, it's not to nitpick or it's not to get into your character. It's a question out of curiosity. And Professor Paul Kotze was, you know, he's an amazing examiner. And you know, I'm always in awe of what he tells the students and how, you know, almost like sideways he goes. And he always says, I have to provoke you because that's my job. And he says it in such a nice way. And we have to ask you questions to understand your understanding. Not to, you know, grind you or grill you. You know, if you go out to that with that intention, we are not human. Okay? So just keep that in mind. We are all as vulnerable because we as examiners, we also feel that vulnerability because we have to ask you intelligent questions and we sit in front of a panel, you know, who is, they are, you know, credible and well-known and famous architects, and you have to ask a question, you know. So we are also put in a very vulnerable spot, and we have the deepest empathy for you guys because we know how it feels to stand there. So that's enough rambling about, you know, how you present yourself.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah. And just one thing that I learned from Paul many, many years ago, and that I've been telling students ever since, is don't make a stand. You know, that's very important. And if somebody asks you makes a comment and asks you a question you don't know, say, my goodness, that is such a good comment. I really appreciate it, but I don't have an answer for that now.
Yeah.
Boof! And then they'll have to go on. What else?
Because many students, you get so nervous with that question or if you can't answer it, that they go on a tangent of something completely different.
Yeah.
And then I say, oh, no, there goes your marks, because, you know, don't go off on a tangent. Like Gerald said, just, you know, if you don't know, you don't know. And it's fair. And, you know, we appreciate, you know, you showing us a little bit of vulnerability as well.
Yeah. Like, you know that one Dutch student who gathered that student in the schema and he couldn't ask it. He said, that's an absolutely brilliant observation.
That
sort of thing. The audience, yeah. I just want to add here, sorry, but what it amounts to is when you do get a question, make sure that you understand the question. Because many students then go off on a tangent because they hear something else of what was intended with the question. So if you're not sure, say, sorry, I'm actually not sure what you are referring to. I'm not sure exactly what you want or whatever it might be. So be honest and make sure, like when you write an exam, if you don't read the question, you cannot answer it. Mm-hmm. So that's quite important.
Thanks for that, Sigurd. Okay, then we have Philip Sherman, and Philip got 70. Is there anything on the dam? Is there anything you'd like to say? It was a good scheme.
It was a good scheme, yes, very good. Just one thing, that was a site where we couldn't orientate ourselves. We were like going from panel to panel and, you know, pointing here and Thomas Honeywell, we were like all over the show. So don't make us confused. that confused us. It's just, he did a really good scheme. I think he did well. I'm not going to say anything.
Yeah. And then we had Christelle. That was your student with 77%.
Yeah, she got very good marks, and I think she was a very nice. She spoke in a very confident way. She looked the part. You know, just dressed neatly on that day. We're not saying you must go to Hilton. Oh no, they closed down. But we don't buy clothes or whatever. Just look neat. It really makes a good impression as well. At least comb your hair or something. You know, put on some makeup. I don't know, guys. Just put on some nice shoes. So yeah. Presentation as such. And she. So I saw last time that I was there. Some of the stuff is still stuck on the floor, and she did a really nice leading up to the presentation, and it carried through those circles. It almost looked like those alien crop circles. It really complemented the design, but it's not necessary for you guys to go and stick vinyls all over the show, so just remember that. I really enjoyed the document. It was a beautiful, engaging document to read. The introduction to detailed design elements as the project unfolds It shows that the design is integrated and the details are not post-rationalized. Okay, so to answer your question, you asked the question of showing some of the detailed stuff beforehand, and she looked at the documents. She really did it in a nice, almost sneaky way to complement her narrative. Okay, then it was an interesting and well-researched topic, and it was a good understanding and thorough research of her existing site conditions. Also, transforming something completely unecological into an ecological observatory is a brave endeavor, and the candidate did this successfully. I think it was a good thing. She did that mine scheme. You guys all know, hopefully, what it did, like if you attended last year. Right. Then, with that, shortcomings was the placing of certain images and diagrams were not always appropriate, and it seemed a bit erratic. So if you are going to choose to lead the reader or the observer, you know, in a way to show detailed stuff, don't make it too complicated. She did a bit of complex things and I was quite confused, but when I got the storyline or whatever, it was fine. But you know, the aspects that will need clarification, how will this facility contribute towards a neighboring town, integration or non-integration? Are you going to contribute or are you not? You know, make a decision and stick with it, you know. But if the question gets asked, you must be able to answer it, okay? Then, how will people know about this facility? Will there be hordes of tourists, or did you intend for it to host only small groups and mostly scientists? And that was what I wanted to know because it wasn't really clear in the document. Then how will the rehabilitation of the site work, and why will the end user buy into the scheme? Can architecture promote natural rehabilitation? Because you know, it was quite a contradictory topic, because here is something completely unecological and now she's slapping architecture on it. And I was really just wondering, you know, the topic was brave, let me just say that, because architecture is unecological, no matter in what way you look at it, you know, and now she's building architecture onto it, and you know, and why not let nature take over? You know, that was my question. And it could be anyone's question, and it could be a question to your thesis as well, and then you should be able to answer that. You know, did she make a deliberate choice, or is the need to attract people bigger than the ecological observation, or is the need to educate people in ecologies and so on more important than the, you know, un-ecology of the architecture? Right, then she had a very credible, well-researched argument. Her theoretical investigation was also good. She showed an understanding of both the ecological and industrial poles of this project. Then, she did detail design with an amazing poetic quality. She did those leaves on the side, and a model was incredible, and well, it was just really good. She always kept the design concept in mind with her resolution. And she used good appropriate references, just a few general comments, a very good document with a lot of attention paid to detail. And then design was resolved on various levels. And she was actually the one who looked at the landscape and the future of that project. So that's very important to look at what will happen in 5 or 10, 20 years' time if your scheme lends itself to it. Don't bother with it if it doesn't. Okay, so yeah. Then some recommendations. Some pages are very full and some pages only contain one image, and rearrange the document so that there is a balance. And that being said, I also think that there's so much to be said about white space. So just plan your layout of your book very carefully. Okay. So no, that's Christophe. I don't know if you want to add anything, Gerald.
No, not to Christophe. No. But what I want to say is what Riëtte mentioned of dressing well, getting your appearance in order. Just so that everybody is aware that you are taking this event seriously. Because a couple decades ago, we had a student who pitched in shorts and sandals and started telling the examiners the poverty he grew up in. He didn't like it.
No,
just said, we don't want to see struggling artists. We want to see ambitious architects.
Professional, ambitious architects.
Yeah.
I mean, I was actually in this house exam for like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And the one question they asked her was, does she have a final sort of render or something more conclusive, like how a design actually looked? And she said no. So what, I don't understand, like, to me it felt a bit like, I don't know if it was just my opinion or what, but it was a bit unresolved. So how do you balance that? Like,
okay,
yeah. How do you know where the line is, like, where do you stop? Where can you, like, go into a bit more conceptual design?
Yeah.
Rather than just designing the entire thing.
Yeah, okay, that's a very good point and a very good question that you make. And art can't tell you where to stop and where to carry on. It's a decision that you must take, and you must say, okay, I'm going to do this here. What I did like was Christelle's stuff, that she really went into detail. Like, I think she went maybe a little too much into detail, and she didn't give us the big picture of what does this thing look like in the end. Her models showed up, but we wanted to see, you know, what materials are those leaves? Is it like a corten? What does it look like when the sun shines on it, you know? And a simple sketch, or, you know, something like a model with a light or something that illustrates that, you know, could have been just helpful towards, you know, even a better mark. So yeah, and that was lacking in so many of the schemes. We want to see, you know, you get lost in all these things, and we want to see, I had the same issue, believe it or not. People wanted to see what does your building look like in the end, and yeah, that's ultimately, yeah, what we sort of missed there. She had this amazing elevation sketch of it, but you know, a better view with more colors, you know, showing the, because Earth thing was about the landscape and so on, and you know, that celebrating the landscape should have, you know, just made the extra cut. No, does that answer your question? More or less, okay. The thing is about design, and maybe, you know, Sig, who has a little bit more experience, or a lot more experience, obviously, he can maybe tell you, I think your mentors will tell you when to stop.
Yeah.
I work in a very fast-paced thing. We have sometimes a week to complete a building, and you know, it's, or 2 days, or whatever. And that's not the way to do it. Always. But in terms of education, you must listen to what your mentors are saying, because I don't think, and if you do, great, but many of you don't have that gauge yet on where to stop and where to, you know, when to carry on. Some people stop too early and you miss opportunities. Some people stop too late and, you know, you also miss opportunities. So there's a fine line. I should say you should stop designing around about August. Set that goal to yourself, you know. Say, I must be confident with my design. And I think that must be a clue for yourself. I must be confident about my design. I must have most of my questions resolved that my mentor have, that I have for myself, and what an external examiner could possibly have for myself. And then you say, okay, I'm done. Does that help a little bit? Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
What can you? Do you want to say something?
I think just to add what Riëtte is saying is design is about one thing only, and especially for architects, and they don't have it, sadly enough. It's about understanding, and that is what the panel is tries to judge from what you've written, what you've drawn, the models that you've built. Is do you understand the problem which you set yourself, number one, and then if you understand the problem, do you understand how to solve that problem? How do you think? So what they are trying to see is how you are thinking, not, now coming back to everything you had to say, not about how you present or whatever, because in the earlier years the guys get, ooh, look at this nice presentation at this level, and they don't see through the smoke and mirrors. Here, you can have as many smoke and mirrors as you have. The more you have, the more it's going to work against you, because they are going to say, oh, this thing is trying to, I'm going to use Riëtte's words, tell bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what is they, what are they trying to hide? Okay, and that I think is the answer. Where you stop, where you end. You've got to communicate those beautiful thoughts that you've had, the understanding that you've had, what the problem is, how you resolve it, and why. And that's it. How you do it, if you can do it by one elevation, you can. I mean, that's not really talking nonsense here, but that's the
yardstick
to measure it.
Okay, excellent. Can you remember, this is now for me the saddest case of the whole exam, can you remember much about Sipo's bridge of his? He got 59%.
Yeah, he just didn't finish.
Yeah, that is, everybody said that.
So and, much opportunity.
And Tommy said this was one of the best books he has ever read in his whole life. You know, the way he argued and the way he did his his drawings, but I don't think it was a matter of time, he just didn't, I don't know.
Yeah,
all they wanted to see were elevations and models, and the other students in the group would, I asked him 40 times every week, when am I seeing a model? Yeah, but I'm looking.
They didn't have a model, that's, you know.
But these beautiful sketches. Yes,
amazing sketches, and that's what actually, can I say that, Gerald? I don't think he deserved to pass because he, he took a chance and he got it, and somehow the panel was in his
But he's not a chancer, but
yeah.
You know, he should have been.
Yeah, his book was well done.
I should have been more forceful.
Yeah, he just had a few, you know, he had a few sketches and then he had bumps there, you know, and then, you know, we had to sort of figure out where it was, and we couldn't see the building in its totality, and, you know, and yeah. Yeah, for me it was just such a disappointment. I don't think I passed him, but because he's so talented, and that was what is my, because I'm harder on those people who are so talented and don't use their talent. It's just, guys, it's finished.
If I could have my life over with, I would see, but I would have put him in my house and check him every evening.
That's a good guy. And he will be out there, but he's going to struggle in the real world because he's not going to realize the seriousness of the deadline. And this is your deadline, guys, and you are getting months to do this. It's more than enough time, believe me. And this is your deadline. Stick to your deadline. You know, because you're going to have many deadlines in the next few years to come. Yeah. Sorry, you wanted to ask.
Yes, that's actually something someone else said to me the other day about having a finished building. That you want to see a finished building because that's what it's going to be like out there when a client comes to you, wants to see a finished building. So is that very important that we have, well, we have to have a result design, but to show a finished design, because earlier on you were talking about conceptual and because we were talking about stopping at a point.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, sorry, you want to finish your question. Okay. Yes, we do want to see a finished building. We want to see the materiality. And what is a finished building? It is something that people can imagine that is going to be there. Whether it's a sketch that shows your form, materiality, light, whether it's a rendering, whether it's a model, we want to see a finished building. Yeah.
It's something your mother can understand.
Yeah, it's something that your mother can understand. Yeah.
Because I was also saying sequels exam.
Yeah, luckily he passed, and hopefully he will learn, but he's going to learn
the
hard way. Yeah.
How many of you have read your learner's guide to study guide? This year. Let me see. Okay. I'll tell you what. If you haven't read it, you are trying to play rugby, but you don't know that you cannot kick over the sideline, whatever the rules are. Those are the rules, and it actually says in the syllabus very clearly, and that's why you have this cloud in your mind, I think. It says, what are the outcomes of this year? What should you prove that you have achieved? And it's actually quite simple. It says that you should prove that you can do appropriate, responsible, sustainable architecture. That's the first thing. Appropriate, responsible, which means it can't be something hanging on skyhooks, it's not responsible. And obviously sustainability doesn't mean green, it means it's spread over many, many areas.
Yeah.
I'm going to leave it at that. It means actually that you are proving that you can, with help, independently design and build a building. That's what it means. So that should answer your question, how far should we go? That is what you should be able to show. That is why you do contract documentation of it, to say, I have mastered this part as well. I can design something, I can work out the details, and I know how those two influence each other. And of course, I'm going to be in practice for another 2 years to learn other things, and then I can practice on my own. So that is, if you are now, if you were surgeons, and you were, let's say, just a normal surgeon, you had to prove in an exam that you can operate on someone and take his appendix out or her appendix without the patient dying. So if you forget to put in the drip and the patient dies, you fail.
No.
That's how it works.
So that's how the patient dies.
Okay, then we got to get to Scott Thompson with his church, and Scott got 72%. And you remember much, he had a very big exhibition.
Yeah, we had a very big exhibition. Some of it was not really necessary, but we enjoyed, there was a small model that we actually enjoyed
many more
than his final model. But it doesn't matter if we enjoy it more or not, it's because you could see what his building is looking like. And he did well. I think there was also a little bit of his form for me was a little bit contrived and so on, but it's such a subjective opinion and so on, but he did well, so we gave him good marks. He's working now at our firm, so he's doing well. Doing very well. He's working in a more project-based team who actually built.
Excellent. Then you want to talk about Bayanda?
Yes, I marked his...
Bayanda got 43%.
Yeah. He unfortunately didn't make it for the second time. And now he's unfortunately out of the system. So just think about it, guys. You have only so many chances. I do think he gives you guys too many chances, but anyway. In real life, you don't get that many chances. In any case, he had a relevant topic. He had a good choice of site, Marabastad. Do one of you guys have a site in Marabastad? Okay. Just keep in mind that it has been so well researched by, and most of your panel will also have done something or proposed something or something in your site. It's a good and a dangerous site to choose. I don't know exactly where Marabastad, but just make sure your homework is done. Okay.